voorheen in grensoorlog.
Die woord communist, dit was die absolute antichrist enzovoort. Maar dit is wat mij geïnspireerd het en gemotiveerd het om te vecht voor mijn land, je weet.
Ik heb altijd voor mijzelf gezegd, ik zal voor mijn land vecht. Ik zal voor mijn land vecht. Maak nie saak wie in bewind was nie. Behalve als daar communisme bewind was. Als daar communisme bewind was, was ek dan het ek 'n vryheidsvegter geword.
Vanaf die laat 60's was daar 'n rus onder elke bed in Suid-Afrika. Woorde soos rooie gevaar en communisme het deel van die woordeskat geword. Vir die wat in Angola en in die noorde van Namibië Russiese toerusting gebuit het en op propagandistiese literatuur afgekom het, was dit 'n harde werklikheid. Die vyand is geborg deur die Sovjet-Unie en Cuba en hulle sou in die spervuur hulle lewe kon verloor met 'n koel uit 'n Russiese wapen. Thuis het literatuur die ronde gedoen met titels soos Wat die communisme werklik is, wat deur die Synodale Kommissie vir die bestryding van maatskaplike ewels van die NG Kerk versprei is. Die subhoofies alleen spreek boekdele. Onskuldige voorkoms van die communisme, aanwakkering van klassehaat en klassestryd, revolusie die hoofdoel, swart republiek, vernietigingsdrang. Op 'n ligter noot het menige troepie sy ledige ure verwyl met verhale soos Tessa en Grensvegter, waar die skurke communiste, Russiese agente en Kubane was.
Natal 1979, Rocco de Wet bekend as die Grensvegter en Karen Berkeman wat soms werk as pion doen ontspan. Hulle ken mekaar al 2 jaar lank. Soms is die gesprek lig, ander kere ernstiger soos nou.
Dis waar, Rocco. Die Oost-Duitsers begin hulle sterk vestig in sekere swart state.
Ek weet, ek het baie met hulle te doen gehad.
Hulle is baie gevaarliker as die Kubane. Slimmer, gedigter, sommer net alles.
Natuurlik, Moskou weet hoe om sy kaarte te speel. Kuba se bydra tot ondermyning in Afrika het sy perk bereik. Nou moet Rusland 'n ander pion gebruik. In die geval is dit Oost-Duitsland.
Kom sit, Rocco. Ons het mekaar lanklaas gesien, en hier, ons is alleen. Kom dans, Rocco, hierdie aand is onsin.
Graag.
En jy moet my beloof.
Wat?
As het zwaar met jou gaan in Angola, denk aan my, denk aan hierdie aand. Onthou, daar is iemand wat ook aan jou denk, verlang, vir jou bid.
Dit beloof ek, want is makkelijk.
O, Rocco, jy moet veilig terugkeer, jy moet nie so baie waag nie. Beloof jy dit ook?
Ek is nooit onvoorsigtig nie.
Ou Suid-Afrika sou verstom gewees het om te weet dat hulle eertydse vyand net so lekker aan die anti-communistiese sentimente gelees het. Nou dat die strydbuil begrawe is, lag die Namibiese minister van verdediging Charles Namolo self daaroor.
Books or comics which were in shops, we were buying them also. Reading and discussing like other youngsters in the country, whether you are white or black, swart, later swart, or what is it?
Later
and swart. Cake, the swart adderall. We were reading all these comics also.
And your love letters.
And Africans also, we were Africans. We loved the language to a certain extent, especially myself. I loved it only when I write love letters, my leaflet, my dear bar, and so forth. When we were writing love letters to our girlfriends, it's all in Afrikaans. We wouldn't write the love letters in English. No, we didn't like them. The wording, maybe only one sentence, and then into Afrikaans. You see, it was very sweet. It's a sweet love language, I can say, but. We came to hate the language because of their attitudes towards us. We said, if it's their language and they don't like us, then we hate it.
Haat het ingetree en vir jare vlak gelê aan albei kante. Suid-Afrikaners het Swapo gesien as marionette van die communisme.
Ons sal nou verder af Afrika, in Suid-Afrika en in Suid-Afrika, ons moet staal en sterk maak om teen hierdie gedigte vyand van ons, namelijk die communiste van al die Russische expansionisme, te veg.
En ons moest dit keer, en dit sal ek vir die troepe op die grens verduidelik het, hoe belangrijk dit was om dit te keer. Dit het ons gedoen. Die ISSR is uiteindelijk verslaan. En het economisch ineengestort in drie groot gebiede. Die eerste gebied was die Midde-Ooste, die tweede gebied was Afghanistan en die derde gebied was Suidelike Afrika. En in Suidelike Afrika het ons die rol gespeel om hom uit te mergel. As ons dit nie gedoen het nie, was werklike demokrasie nie in Suider-Afrika nie. Dan het ons hier gesit met 'n klomp communistische satellietstate.
75 jaar tevore het daar 'n heel ander verhouding bestaan. In 1900 het Russiese soldate die boere kom help veg teen die Britse onderdrukker. Die Bolsky-familie se oupa Grootjie was een van hulle.
The story of the family as an architect started from great-grandfather. He was born in 1874 and became a first architect in the family.
He's very popular in Russia. Every architect in our country maybe knew that my grandfather was in Transvaal.
When he was 26 years old, he joined the Russian troops and went in South Africa to fight on the side of Boers against English troops. He spent about 1 year in South Africa, and through this the word of Boers and the word of South Africa was something like miracle in our family.
This is an article about Англо-Бурская война и воспоминания русского волонтера, так.
The war with English and Boers and remembers of the Russian volunteer.
He was in the security team around Kruger, and when Kruger was leaving the country, they were discussing with Kruger the problems of the end of the war, and everybody understood that the war is, they lost the war.
In totaal het 225 Russiese vrywilligers na Suid-Afrika gekom om die boere te ondersteun. Sommige as soldate, ander as mediese personeel. Terug by die huis was daar groot steun vir wat hulle gedoen het.
Everybody knew that he was in the war in South Africa. Everybody started to sing this song about Transvaal, Transvaal.
Transvaal, Transvaal, страна родная. Это вот very popular song. And мама, купи мне пушку, барабан, я поеду к бурам бить англичан.
So in English it will say like, mother bought me a gun and a rifle and I shall go and I shall join Boers to beat English. He always underlined that when he tell about his involvement in Boers war, everybody was very excited and started to support him and started to sing songs and that it was very, very sensitive somewhere in the spirit of Russians who remembered the times of the beginning of the century of this war.
Die sympathie tussen Afrikaners en Russe het behoue gebly deur die eerste aantal dekades van die 20ste eeuw. Selfs communisme, later so skelwoord, het 'n sterk aanhang gehad. Dit het duidelik geblyk tydens die werkersopstande van 1922.
In 1922 was daar reeds meer Afrikaner werkers, of veral in die myne, as Engelssprekende, ek praat van wit werkers. En dis baie goed bekend dat daar hierdie beroemde mars in 1922 was, waar onder leiding van Afrikaner werkers daar actief gesê is ons beëiwer ons vir 'n communistische bestel ten einde ons situasie te verbeter.
In die Tweede Wêreldoorlog veg Suid-Afrikaanse soldate saam met die Sowjetunie, Brittanje en ander geallieerdes teen Hitler se Duitsland. Gewone lede van die publiek organiseer aksies soos om bloed te skenk, spesifiek vir die Russiese soldate. Maar een groot groep mensen, vooral Afrikaners, voel baie sterk teen samenwerking met die Britte, wat hulle steeds sien as die vijand van een kort 40 jaar tevore.
Ons moet een ding onthou van die 40er jare. Stalin en die Russe het saam met die geallieerdes gevecht in Hitler. En daar was onder Afrikaners een geweldige groot sympathie geweest met Hitler. Omdat hy een vijand was van die Engelse. Dit was die standpunt van my enemy's enemy is my friend. Verder is interessant dat in 1950 is die wet op die onderdrukking van communisme ook aanvaard. So wat gebeur het, is dat daar is een duidelijke alliantie aangegaan tussen Afrikaner nationalisme, Christendom en kapitalisme.
Intussen het zwart Suid-Afrikaanse politici oor baie jare contact gemaakt met Moskou. In 1927 het die president van die ANC die stad besoek. Oor die volgende dekades is honderde ANC-lede in die Sovjet-Unie opgelei. Die bevrydingsorganisaties van Namibië het diezelfde patroon gevolg. Soos die oorlog in die subcontinent opgevlam het, het daar die ondersteuning uitgebrei.
A period of time during which the Soviets took every advantage to deploy their forces and to project their power, both land power and air power, and to some extent naval power, into the developing world, the third world.
This was the struggle within the framework of the global split of the world, the contraposition between the military blocs. Africa was a collision center, the Middle East was a collision center, Asia,
Cambodia,
same thing.
Central America.
Hierdie internationale machtskaakspel sou die lewe van duisende gewone troepe in Rusland, Suid-Afrika, Cuba, Angola en Namibië oor die volgende paar dekades vir altyd verander. Die wat deur die geweerloop gekyk het, kon nie altyd die groter prentjie sien nie. SWAPO het destyds naburige Afrika-state as afspringplekke en basisse gebruik om aanvalle te loods in Namibië. In die Angolese kookpot was daar drie ander guerrilla-bewegings in aksie. Sowjet-adviseurs het SWAPO gehelp en ook die MPLA van Angola. Suid-Afrika het op hulle beurt UNITA en die FNLA ondersteun. Russiese soldate is as adviseurs in Angola ontplooi vanaf die mid-70s tot die laat-80s.
Because if not we, Americans could be there. That is all. Because practically all the time the great states, great powers, yes, they have their own conflict between each other.
Anyway, war is war. It was big politics.
This is what was used by the South Africans, that those are communists. They are surrogates of the Russians, surrogates of the China, surrogates of communists, what, everything, just to discredit our endeavor to liberate ourselves. And it is not that we wanted only to go to the communist or socialist countries, because they were willing to help us. If you can't help us, we go to those who are willing to help us.
Speaking about the puppet, why puppet? We were soldiers. And South Africans were also soldiers.
We were a military part of that politics, instrument of that politics.
Dit was nie net soldate wat die instrument van die politiek was nie.
At that time Angola was supported by the Soviet Union, so, and it got all the armament, practically all the armament from the Soviet Union and of course from the socialist countries. I saw the armament from German Democratic Republic, from Bulgaria, from Czechoslovakia. But at the same time, when we fought against the UNITA and South Africa, we captured, for example, in their bases, for example, after the battles, we captured Chinese, Israel, and American, of course, Belgian rifles and machine guns and so on, so everything.
Die wapens is eenvoudig afgelever en gebruik. Die soldaten moest na hulle self omsien.
The Soviets had to report to the high command, and the high command told, listen, you need to stay there, you shoot, you must stay there with Angolan troops, but take care of your security. In what way to take care of our security, we didn't know, but take care of your security, but you stay, you just stay with Angolan troops.
Sekuriteit in 'n oorlogsone, soos wat Angola destyds was, was maar 'n relatiewe begrip. Om gewond of in hegtenis geneem te word, 'n daaglikse moontlikheid. Tydens operasie Protea in 1981 het die inhegtenisname van 'n Russiese sergeant-majoor opslag gemaak. Dit is hoe die SAW dit gerapporteer het.
Hy het terugbeweeg na die peloton toe om aan te sluit by en om te onttrek na sy tydelike basis toe. En tydens die terugbeweging is daarop hulle gevuur vanaf skuins agter hulle. Hulle het omgedraai en die vuur beantwoord en op die daaropvolgende deursoeking het hulle toe hierdie lewendige rus plus die dooies daar gekry.
Volgens die Instituut van Afrika Studies in Moskou, boer Nikolai vandag op die Russiese platteland.
If I didn't want to go to Africa or anybody of my friends who didn't want to go to Africa, they could have written a report. I don't want to go. And he would not go. That's it. Problem is solved. We have to understand any military is an instrument which sometimes participate in combat actions. We cannot escape that. And if a parent of South African soldier who has died in while fighting Namibians trained by me, I would have answered, I think, the same way. He's a soldier. Soldiers are dying sometimes in battle. What to do? We are paid for that.
We were taught and we were instructed to help our brothers in order to gain their independence, in order to have their country flourishing and so on, in order to repel all the attacks of the international imperialism and so on.
Namibians, people who lived there thousands of years, they wanted to live there the way they wanted. They have their right to struggle for the way they wanted to live.
Many of them really wanted to get this help from us, you see, and so, as you say, identify myself with those purposes. Of course, we are identified.
They were comrades in arms. They were always ready to sacrifice with us. And the little they had to share with us. So they were real comrades, and they will teach you how to survive under very difficult circumstances.
They have the right to apply to anybody to help them to be trained. If it didn't come there to be to train them, definitely the vacuum would be filled by somebody else who is more bloodthirsty than the Soviet officer. We didn't tell them to cut throats of the victims. Never, never, ever.
Dit was nie aldag maklik vir die Russiese adviseurs om aan te pas by wat hulle in die veld in Angola ondervind het nie.
I don't want to offend Angolan soldiers now.
Some of them had nothing, neither skills nor wish to struggle, just to eat, to drink, to dance and nothing more.
Die SWAPO kaders was anders, sê hulle.
I enjoyed the moment when I could distinguish immediately. This is SWAPO soldier, this is Angolan soldier. A SWAPO soldier, when he was walking through the streets of Lubango, maybe in old uniform, maybe, but it is always nicely washed. It is always pressed. Their shoes are polished, if not by that polisher, standard polisher, at least by the fat of meat he is eating, but it is polished. When Angolan soldiers sometimes would have one boot broken and never repaired, and never uniform is not pressed.
Maar hoe het hulle die Suid-Afrikaanse soldate gesien?
South African troops were very well organized, were very well trained, very well professional, you see. They were the real professional troops, and they knew what for they were fighting, you see. And of course, they got a very good salary.
Alles was echter nie net die spreekwoordelike skop skiet en doodslaan nie.
Best memory. I told you, a very good nature. Very beautiful nature of Angola. Well, of course, you do not remember bad things, you remember only good things. I remember a lot of good things, you see. And I had a very good possibility to see everything with my own eyes, you see, and to touch with my own hands, and to swim in the African rivers, and to swim in the Atlantic Ocean, and to cross the country in the vehicle, you see, and to fly all the country.
Maar hulle was ook bewus van waarvoor hulle geveg het.
So I do remember those times with biggest pleasure and the fact that I estimate that they are now in Namibia. Well, I hope that a piece of my invention is also there. I also help them to be there in a democratic society. And I also envy the way Namibians managed to reconcile the country. Unfortunately, here in the Soviet Union, we were remembering who was on the white guy side, on the Red Army side, till now.
Basiese verskille het soms meer indruk gemaak as enige ideologie.
To say the truth, we considered the UNITA troops as the enemies. And the majority of Russians did not consider South Africans. Maybe because I am not a racist, but maybe because of they were white people, you see, and we were white people. I learned a very good rule from Africa from the very beginning. If you see a white man in Africa, just from the very beginning, he is your friend. Because there were no so many whites, for example, in Angola and in Mozambique. And if you see a white man, your honor and your debt is to help him if he has some troubles.
11 jaar na die oorlog het Igor Jedarkin in Mosambiek in 'n Suid-Afrikaanse soldaat vasgeloop. In die stryd het hulle aan teenoorgestelde kante van die geweerloop gelê.
He asked me, "Aren't you angry? Why? What for? How can I be angry with you if you just fulfilled your part of your debt? I fulfilled my debt and that is all."
Volgende week in Grensoorlog, Operasie Savannah. 3000 kilometer deur die Angolese bos.